Welcome to ETC. Today we will be discussing a case of HIV along with the dengue co-infection. Morning, sir. Sir, an old middle-aged man was brought to ER. I got a short history from the EMT that he has been referred from outside hospital in view of suspected dengue infection.
Okay.
So when I saw the patient, initial 10-second assessment, patient is fully conscious oriented and was able to completely respond to my question, sir. So I went to the primary survey. Primary survey, airway is patent, no oral circulation, cervical spine is within normal limit, no tongue fall was there. Breathing, air entry bilaterally equal, saturation was maintaining 99% in room air with a respiratory rate of hardly 18 per minute, sir. Circulation, his BP was maintaining around 128/80 millimeters of mercury, but mild tachycardia was there around between 100 to 110 tachycardia was there. But all
what are the reasons for tachycardia in a patient who is having fever?
Sir, fever itself can
fever
be
itself
a tachycardia
can, okay.
cause, anxiety can be a cause, pain can be a cause, or associated myocarditis.
Okay.
Can be a cause.
Unexpected tachycardia, you have to be very careful.
Yes, sir.
If temperature is there, tachycardia is not. Temperature is normal in a patient who is taken paracetamol or something. If the tachycardia is present, you have to always suspect myocarditis. That is the first reason. Second one is like thyroid dysfunction, thyroiditis.
Yes. So circulation was normal, all peripheral pulses were within per palpable. So then I went to the disability. GCS was 15/15, pupils were 2.5 mm bilaterally reactive. We checked the temperature also at that time. Temperature was around just 98 degree Fahrenheit. And GRBs also we checked at that time. It was slightly around 244 milligrams per deciliter was there. So then I went to the exposure. Exposure peripheries were warm. Anyway, warm blanket was given to cover him, sir. So as an adjunct to the reassessed the primary survey, everything was within normal limits, sir. So at that time, from the short history, he was complaining of mild chest pain. So as an adjunct, we did only an ECG and was done, but ECG was showing only sinus tachycardia was there, and lateral leads small T inversions were there, but it was already in the previous ECG.
Okay.
Since he was complaining chest pain,
what is the age of the patient?
He's 63, sir. 63. So anyway, we sent for a point of care drop. I also asked as an adjunct, sir. And
lateral leads, you get TVO inversion. What all things you will look in that TVO? How do you know that it is pathological, physiological? How do you assess the reasons for that? Any TVO inversion you take, any TVO inversion you are seeing in the ECG, how do you know that it is pathological?
Symmetrical.
Only symmetry. Descending limb and ascending limb of TVO, is there symmetrical, then it is significant. Then one more significant criteria is there. For any change in ECG, more than two consecutive leads, you should have change. So if you have the same type of change in two leads, if TVO inversions are symmetrical, both the descending and ascending are symmetrical, then that is mostly pathological. Rarely it can be physiological. But in only lateral lead ischemia is very, very rare. But patient who is having hypertension, LVH, all these things, you can get a TVO inversion.
It's an old CAD also.
Okay, old CAD also you can get.
So, fine. And the point of care drop I was also asked, which came to be negative initially, sir. So, I went to the secondary survey.
So, when you are having a fever patient, why do you want to do troponin I? Other than cardiac
associated myocarditis, we can check, sir. Okay. Myocarditis, muscle injury will be there, drop eye will be elevated.
Without myocarditis, can you get troponin I elevation?
In case of underlying CKD or acute kidney injury also, cardiac enzymes will be elevated.
Even sepsis, many patients
sepsis
who is having toxemia, hypoxemia, there is no lesion in the heart, but because of this problem, heart is not getting
PNK
adequate blood
also
supply. So there also you can get. So all troponin I, troponin T elevation in fever patient is not due to cardiac lesion. Can be a pre-cardiac lesion also possible.
So I went to the secondary survey, sir. No history of any allergies. Medication history, he was on antiplatelets along with oral hypoglycemic agents for the past several years, but he discontinued everything for the past 9 months, sir.
Okay.
That was his medication history. And last meal was his breakfast. And even lead to the arrival is the patient is having dysuria for the past 2 weeks, and he has developed a fever with chills for the past 1 week. And he was taking his own medication. medication, but he developed an episode of hematuria and bleeding PR, following which he visited a local physician, and where his routine blood investigations were done and found to be that his platelet is less than 1 lakh. So they did a screening for dengue alone. In that, NS1 was negative, but IgM came to be positive, following which they have referred to a tertiary center. Okay. That was the event for his arrival.
How many days fever?
He was 1 week.
1 week.
2 weeks at dysuria is there for 2 weeks. Okay. So then other than that, there is no any history of any petechial hemorrhages or any bleeding comes or nothing was there. Only one episode of suspected hematuria and bleeding PR was only there, sir. After that, there was no malina, no hematuria.
What are the reasons for hematuria in elderly individuals?
Hematuria, one may be due to hematuria, sir. Hematuria means then it may be due to renal calculi, glomerulonephritis, or it may be due to renal cell carcinoma or even a urinary tract infection. Yes, cystitis,
trauma,
prostate enlargement. All this can produce hematuria. Okay. Even low platelet also can produce, but here it is 1 lakh.
1 lakh. So so that was his event for arrival. A negative history, nothing else was significant. So then I went to the head to foot examination. The head and the cervical spine, everything were within normal limit, no conjunctival hemorrhage.
We should not tell like that. What are the things you look in the head and spine? Cervical area?
We have to look for any cervical lymphadenopathy.
Okay, that is very important. Cervical lymphadenopathy is most important in this type of cases. If you are examining the fundus, hemorrhage is also important.
Like no conjunctival hemorrhage.
Okay. Oral bleeds, dental bleeds, all these
gums,
things.
Everything, no bleed, nothing was there, sir. And coming to chest, air entry is bilaterally equal. No visible any petechial hemorrhages or dilated veins, nothing were there. And saturation and respirator already
acute
is maintained.
Acute fever with cervical lymphadenopathy, what is a common cause?
IMN.
Infectious mononucleosis. As an emergency physician, what you should avoid in that condition?
Amoxicillin.
Amoxicillin, Augmentin, Ampicillin, all these things should be avoided. Avoid.
Okay. Chest examination were within normal limit. Abdomen examination, mild abdominal tenderness were there, but that too mildly in the splenic area. But it was not so tender, mild tenderness only on deep palpation, sir. Otherwise, per abdomen was also within normal limit. Bowel sounds were present, sir. Since he was complaining of bleeding, we examined the orifices, but there was no hematuria, no active bleeding PR, nothing was there, sir. Okay. No visible external hemorrhoids, nothing was there. And musculoskeletal examination, no other positive findings were there with no focal neurological deficits. Everything was within normal limit. So with this history and first investigation, we sent for the routine investigation, sir. And in the routine investigation, we came to found that CRP is elevated 168, the hemoglobin of 13, platelet.
What are the inflammatory markers in a fever case?
Acute phase reactants, ferritin, LDH.
There are positive acute phase reactants and negative. What are the positive acute reactions?
This CRP, ferritin, LDH.
Procalcitonin also acute phase reactant, but it is more in favor of bacterial infection.
Negative is albumin.
Albumin, proteins. Okay, these are the two important things.
So his platelet was only 69,000 when he came here. Okay. Sodium was 120.
When you get a platelet found like this 69,000, what is the important investigation you would
peripheral
ask?
Smear, as you
so
say.
Always ask for a peripheral smear.
Platelet count.
Okay. That is very important.
And sodium was 127, potassium 4.3, procal was 1.63, mildly elevated, sir. Okay. Urea was 50, creatinine was 1.16, UTPT within normal limit, alkaline phosphate is 71, total bilirubin also normal, only 1.0, sir.
Urea is mildly elevated. What are the reasons for
dehydration.
Dehydration is most important. Muscle injury. All these things can produce bleeding. Okay.
Coagulation, INR, APTT were within normal limits, sir. And total CK, we sent say that set of cardiac enzyme were sent. In that only total CK mildly 314, sir.
Okay, what may be the reason for that?
Maybe my
viral fever. Or any injection, injections.
So other than that, we sent for the urine routine examination, which was showing numerous pus cells.
Okay.
Following which, since the procal is also elevated, urine was showing, we sent for both blood and urine culture, sir.
Okay.
So in blood culture, it seemed to be shown Staphylococcus aureus. Mm. Urine culture, again Staphylococcus aureus was growing, sir. And since he is actually a chronic alcoholic and smoker also, we did a screening ultrasound abdomen also. It was showing only altered echo structure with maintained corticomedullary defect.
When you get maintained a Staphylococcus aureus, Suppose you are getting only in one blood culture, it may be a
contamination.
Here urine is positive, blood is positive, same organ. So possibly there is a staphylococcal infection. What you want to know when you get a staphylococcal infection?
You
want to know whether it is MRSA or MSSA. That is very important. Whether it is MRSA or MSSA?
MSSA.
Okay.
And chest X-ray was also done, which was also within normal limits. Okay. Normal, no significant findings were there. So, we didn't say anything.
Staphylococcal pneumonia, what will be the typical X-ray picture?
Pneumatoceles.
Multiple cavitating lesions, bilateral involvement is classical finding.
We did send for the dengue also, sir. Dengue screening, and in that in our hospital, IgM, IgG, and NSN both three all came negative, sir.
Okay.
And so, and if since he was admitted initially to the ICU for stabilization, we sent for the routine pre-op serology investigations were also sent, which came to be positive for HIV, sir, which later was confirmed with ELISA also.
Okay.
So we came to the provisional diagnosis.
How do you diagnose HIV in lab investigation wise?
Usually we have the spot test, sir. CAR test is there. If it is positive, then we'll have to confirm with the ELISA test.
Normally we have to take a consent before doing HIV ELISA. Then once ELISA is positive, 99.9% it is sensitive. So it will be mostly positive. There is no need to do another investigation like Western blot or second ELISA, because the newer generation ELISAs are very accurate. No need to do another investigation, but textbook says you want to do one more investigation to confirm. So we don't do that. So ELISA is positive. Okay. So you want to take this as a dengue fever or a staphylococcal infection?
Right now, since our dengue screening everything is negative, you'll have to take it as staphylococcal infection.
It looks like a staphylococcal infection in an immunocompromised patient.
So he was admitted to ICU, and he was initially, before the blood cultures, we started him on in your suspected urinary tract infection. Ceftriaxone was started, sir. And
Ceftriaxone is a good drug for urinary tract infection. Once you know that the culture is staphylococcus, what antibiotic you would like to change?
To change gram positive coverage.
What is the ideal drug?
Augmentin or linezolid.
Okay, cloxacillin is the ideal drug. Cloxacillin, all are ideal drug. If you give Augmentin, that also will cover. Okay.
So after the culture, we changed the antibiotics. Sir. The culture we got only 3 days later.
Okay.
So initially, we started on him on ceftriaxone.
Okay.
So we came with the provisional diagnosis. The patient is having a sepsis, fever.
Ceftriaxone also covers gram positive, okay, but not like penicillins.
Okay. So he was came with the provisional diagnosis. The patient is having sepsis with fever, sepsis with thrombocytopenia, and an immunocompromised state with uncontrolled sugars. HbA1c was 13, sir.
13.
With uncontrolled sugars, sir, and possible bleeding manifestation secondary to thrombocytopenia. That is a Curie.
What is complicated UTI?
Whenever there is an associated derangement in the renal function test, sir, then
renal function test is not correct. In male, somebody is having a structural deformity, like prostate enlargement or strictures, stones, all these things, or patient is having immunocompromised state like diabetes or HIV. That is also complicated UTI. What is the difference between simple UTI and complicated UTI?
Complicated UTI, we have to treat on IV antibiotics.
Sometimes you'll have to treat IV antibiotics. Simple UTI, 5 to 7 days treatment is enough.
Prolonged.
Other one is prolonged treatment, more than 2 weeks, and you have to correct the basic problem. If it is diabetes, diabetes should be controlled.
So that was his provisional diagnosis, sir. After with the treatment, he actually symptomatically got improved, and he was now planning to get discharged today, sir.
Okay, so when somebody is symptomatically improved, you know that it is MSS, patient is improving on ceftriaxone, you are getting a culture of methicillin susceptible staphylococcus, should we change the antibiotic or continue the antibiotic?
Ideally, we can continue.
If the patient is improving clinically, we should continue the antibiotic. Unnecessary, no need to change. If this is strongly, patient is deteriorating or strongly against the antibiotic what we are given, then you may have to change. Otherwise, it is not required.
That's the indication, sir. Okay. Other than that, some things I want to add is, if in case of suspected dengue, what are the warning signs?
Okay. If it is a dengue case, what are the red flags in management?
If any patient is complaining of abdominal pain, or the patient is having persisting vomiting, and if say his hematocrit is increasing along
what it indicates, increasing hematocrit indicates?
He said that space low.
Vascular leak and loss of intravascular volume.
Okay. Along with thrombocytopenia if he is developing or any kind of any bleeding.
Here thrombocytopenia mostly it is due to retroviral infection than dengue fever.
Or in case of any bleeding manifestations, sir.
Any clinical
fluid accumulation if it is detected and associated lethargy, sir, the major warning signs.
Okay.
And as such, this
what is dengue shock syndrome?
Sir, dengue shock syndrome comes under the subspectrum of dengue hemorrhagic fever. Entire dengue hemorrhagic fever is divided into four types, sir.
Okay.
And then dengue hemorrhagic fever, one is that a patient is having no bleeding manifestations, only third space fluid loss, or edema, it only is there.
Why third space? Loss
due to hyperalbumin loss. Is there inflammatory?
It is due to intravascular leakage. It's the most important problem in dengue.
Okay. So that's it.
So when you have a dengue shock syndrome, how do you treat the patient?
We have to treat the patient just like any shock, sir. We have to initiate full crystalloid, IV crystalloid, 20 to 30 ml per kg bolus, followed by maintenance dose has to be done. Along with, if the associated severe hypoalbuminemia is there, if the patient is affordable, albumin correction should also be given, sir.
And like any other shock, you can start noradrenaline.
So in dengue hemorrhagic fever, only if you are doing a tourniquet test, only we will see petechial hemorrhages.
Okay. It is called as HESS test.
HESS test. In dengue hemorrhagic fever 2 is that some bleeding, like bleeding from gums or anything will be there. So dengue shock syndrome, to call that dengue shock syndrome, it is comes under dengue hemorrhagic fever class 3 or 4. In class 3, there is signs of shock will be there, decreased urine output, systolic BP will be low, such features will be there. And if there is no pulse or BP detectable state, then we call it as dengue hemorrhagic fever class 4. So class 3 and 4 comes under dengue shock syndrome. So these are the two things. As such, WHO treatment, only symptomatic flow management along with the IV hydration is recommended for dengue fevers.
This patient is having diagnosed to have retroviral infection. What do you do for this patient in ICU?
Retroviral infection, if you are detected at according to the current guideline, irrespective of the CD4 count, we have to start him on
ART. How retroviral infection affects our body?
It actually invades the helper T cells, sir. And so it actually reduces the immunity of the cell. So it is
both it can reduce the qualitatively and quantitative of the CD4 count. So sometimes CD4 count may be normal, patient will have features of AIDS. Sometimes CD4 count is low, the patient can have. So qualitative and quantitative reduction can occur.
As such, the entire HIV infection can be divided into four stages. The first one is the initial infective stage, where the just patient develops only some convalescent changes, symptoms only will be there. Then he will remain for a prolonged period of asymptomatic phase. Then before that, AIDS-related symptoms he may develop. And final stage is AIDS stage. To say that the patient has gone into complete AIDS, that his CD4 count should come less than 200, or he should develop any AIDS-defining symptoms, like any opportunistic infections or AIDS related malignancies, like a Kaposi's sarcoma.
When you start ART in HIV?
Sir, according to present guideline, an ART should be initiated as soon as he is diagnosed with.
What are the preferred regimes now?
Right now, present regimen is dalteglavir, emtricitabine plus tenofovir should be started.
What an emergency doctor should know is when to stop ART. Somebody is coming on ART, when to stop ART. Should we stop ART, or when we have a needle prick injury or whatever it is, whether how to start post exposure prophylaxis? Can you tell about that?
When
this patient is on ART, will he stop ART at any reason?
No, sir. ART should not be
ART should not be stopped without any major reason. Only problem ART in ICU can produce is some ART drugs can produce lactic acidosis, like sidovudine, lamivudine, and all. Otherwise, there is no reason to stop ART. We have to continue ART, whatever may be the circumstances.
And when to start post-exposure prophylaxis is that ideally we should start as early as possible, which is the best recommended if you start within 24 hours. Again, the current regimen is...
Suppose one healthcare professional, or nurse or you need after getting a needle prick injury in the night time, what you do?
We will prescribe the again combination of dial.
Before that, we have to confirm the person who is getting a needle prick injury
is not having
HIV. That is the first investigation to do. Then,
and if the patient is there, from the where the patient he got,
then you have to assess the prick injury. What is the type of prick injury? Whether it's a bored needle, or blunt needle, scalpel injury, splash, all these things are different. Rates are
rate of transmission.
Most important is IV cannulas. IV cannulas contain large amount of blood, so they have more infectious this one material.
So, and we should also confirm the serology of the patient from which we took the samples.
Ideally, we have to counsel ourselves. The person who is getting needle prick will have a lot of mental trauma, so we have to counsel how it spreads, what are the ways we can prevent it, how long we have to take tablet, after taking tablet what should be done. Everything should be told to the person, then only we can start ART. How do you start ART?
Again, we have to continue dalticaravir plus emtricitabine plus tenofovir combination tablet once daily for minimum 28 days. And ideally, we should check on the screening initially. Then we'll have to check after 1.5 months. And then at the 3rd month also.
Normally, we can do ELISA only. That is enough. If somebody want to know, better test is PCR test. Qualitative assay of HIV can be done after 1 month. If it is negative, there is no need to continue. According to NACO guidelines, you have to do 1st month at the end of the treatment, then 6 months. So that much investigation should be done. What happened to this patient afterwards?
This patient, we actually sent the CD4 count was 10, sir. It was only 22. We started him on ART, and along with the, we started him on PCP prophylaxis also.
What is PCP prophylaxis?
It is pneumococcus carinii infection causing
pneumocystis carinii or pneumocystis gyrovesi.
Patient can develop pneumonia secondary to this opportunistic infection. So we will have to give clotrimazole.
You can have tablets or injections. Like Bactrim DS, Septrin DS. The only thing is, in urinary tract infection, this drug is commonly used, or any pneumonia you can use. It mainly covers gram negative, but here we use 2 tablets TID or IV is available, that also can be used.
So for prophylaxis, we can give trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole in once daily.
DS tablet. Here also you have to give double strength tablets. Once daily.
We have to give it daily for at least, we have to continue till the CD count is more than 200 for at least 3 months, sir. Otherwise, we have to explain him all the other opportunistic infections.
So you are starting ART here in this patient. What are the problems you anticipate when you are starting ART in this patient? So ART should be started for any patient, but here you should be very careful in this patient.
Sepsis can worsen because sudden increase in what inflammatory marker.
It's called as high risk. Inflammatory reconstitution syndrome. What happens is, whenever somebody is having an infection, because of this low CD4 count, they will not show any inflammatory response. That's why you are not getting procalcitonin high. So sometimes ESR will be normal, CRP will be normal, but when you start ART without treating the primary infection, whatever it may be, there will be aggravation in the immunity, there will be aggravation in the symptoms of the disease. So that should be taken with caution. Then
otherwise, is that since he developed an episode of hematuria, then we have to suspect any AIDS related diarrhea or anything is also there.
So their only thing is, whenever somebody is having diarrhea, you have to send acid fast bacillus test, like cryptosporidium, isosporidium, and all. AFP will be positive. That should not be taken as TB disease. When you see HIV infection, most important infection for a ER physician is PCP pneumonia. How do they present?
Patient will have severe tachypnea and symptoms, but X-ray findings might not be significant.
They have disproportionate symptom than clinical signs. How do you manage it?
Again, we have to start him on
clotrimazole injection or tablet. Use of steroids?
Steroids, yes sir, it should be started.
Even if the patient's immunity is very low, we have to start steroids. In many of these patients having severe hypoxemia. What are the emergencies in HIV infection?
other emergencies are patient can develop HIV encephalitis, can be done, okay. CMV retinitis.
HIV encephalitis is not an emergency. HIV encephalitis.
HIV
related disease like patient can have cryptococcal meningitis, toxoplasma, encephalitis. So like that emergencies are different. Patient can have PCP pneumonia, eye infection, CMV retinitis. These are all emergencies. HIV encephalitis is a slowly progressive disease, not an emergency. How is the patient now?
Patient has improved drastically, sir, okay. And we are discharging the patient too.
How do you want to, when you want to do the CD4 count? Because we cannot offer anything now. We have started ART, we have controlled the urinary tract infection. How do you want to do the CD4 count?
Six.
CD4 count should be done only, ideally it should be after 3 weeks.
Three weeks
we can do it, but it will not improve. It should be, so we are doing it only after nearly 1 year, after 6 months or 1 year. A significant change can be done only after 1 year, 100 will be there. Three weeks should be for viral load, okay, not for CD4 count. CD4 count is only after 1 year, months or 1 year. 1 year is ideal because it increases by 100. Viral load should be done after 3 weeks. What should be the viral load after 3 weeks? It should be undetectable. It's not an emergency topic, so we'll not go into that. How is the patient now? Can we discharge the patient?
Yes, we are discharging the patient.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks.